Good afternoon. This is Jer'me Franklin here representing CGTTV. I have the pleasure of having vocalist Eric Nolan by my side. Eric, how are you today?
Good, sir. How you doing?
Doing fabulous. Thank you. Eric, just to jump right into things, tell me, when did you begin your singing career?
As far as I can remember, I think I was like 4 years old. I used to emulate James Brown. I used to take a chair, and that would be my step to get up on the table. So I used to step up on the chair to get up on the table, and this was my stage. And so what I would do is I would be dancing on my mother's table. I always got whoopings because I was just wondering, well, how did she know I was on the table? But I just scuffed up the table, man. I ain't thinking it that far through. I just know I just wanted to be like James Brown. And then my mother started taking me to bars, and I would dance for change, and they would throw change on the floor, and my mother would gather up the change, and that's how we would eat. She would buy some pinto beans, or some navy beans, or some butter beans, you know what I'm saying? We get some ham hocks put in, we eat, and we have something to eat for like three or four days. So as far as I remember back when I was 4 years old.
Excellent. Now, so you're a native of Cleveland, right?
Born and raised.
Okay. Yeah.
What part of Cleveland, man?
Superior. I'm all through there from 110th all the way to 125th. I actually went to Chesterfield on 123rd and Superior, and then I went over to Patrick Henry to the 7th grade. Left Patrick Henry and went to Harry Davis from the remainder of the 7th grade to the 9th grade, and from the 10th grade to the 12th grade, John Hay.
Okay, so John Hay alum.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, all right, good deal. So you then stepped out. You've been working with the OJs?
Yeah, I had a journey to that, though. But my journey was, I used to have a singing group here called the Deltones. And we pride ourselves in trying to become the number one group, because we didn't have a record out, and the Dazz Band did. So Dazz Band was the darlings of Cleveland at the time. Right. After the OJs. OJs was like the superheroes of Cleveland, and then came the Dazz Band, you know. And we knew that we didn't have a record, but we knew we had to be as good as them. So we kind of like we did good on the local scene here, and then I landed a job with Dennis Edwards from the Temptations. I landed a background gig with him along with Devin Eastburg. We both was singing backgrounds for him. And so that was my little touch of fame. And then I met a kid named Gerald Levert. Gerald was 13 at the time when I met him. Actually, Gerald was the guy who idolized the Deltones. He liked our group. So he always wanted to sing group. Gerald at the time was a solo artist. At that time, when he was 13, 14 years old, he was a solo artist. Sean played the drums. Mark played keyboards. So they were part of the band. But Gerald always wanted a singing group. He wanted a singing group like his dad. Once he saw the Deltones, he really wanted a singing group, because they opened up for us at the Glenville Festival.
Wow.
Back in the day, Gerald did the Glenville Festival, and we were the headliners. And me and Gerald became very good. We became so close that we became like, we were like brothers. We were inseparable for about 8-9 years. We were inseparable. I was always at the house. I was always helping him write, or we were writing together, or we was always doing something with music. And that's me. I'm a music head. So Gerald was doing everything I wanted to do. My guys are cool, but I don't know if they was as intricate as I was. They love music, they love singing and all that stuff, but I was thinking out the box. And they can understand why I would hang around Gerald Levert, because he was so much younger than me. But he had it then. At 15 years old, Gerald had it then. You know what I mean?
I can remember.
So it started around that time, way before the J's. And my relationship with Gerald is what got me to the J's. Right. Because when the OJs was looking for a third member, he told his father about me,
because Gerald knew that my history. In other words, Gerald knew how, as me being a historian of music, it wouldn't matter who called me. I mean, if somebody called me and wanted me to replace the Dramatics, the Stylistics, Intruders, Delphonics, Enchant, it didn't matter. I knew everything about every group, every artist, because that's what I did daily, night and day. I knew everything about them. So when I got the call about doing the OJs, Eddie and Walter still wasn't sold on me. Eddie was trying me out because his son said so. Walter was basically like, if he can get the parts, cool. If he don't, get him out of here. What they didn't know is that I was a fan. The OJs were like my favorite group.
Oh, really? Wow.
So I knew the history of them since they was five. I used to watch them come to Thurgood Marshall and perform in front of for free concerts, you know, in the park. I used to watch them then when they had Bill Iles, Wim Powell, and Bobby Massey with Eddie and Walter. So I got every album they ever made to this day. I mean, I got looking through. I mean, I got coming through when the flowers coming up through the concrete. That was their very first album. I got everything they ever did. So I was an avid fan. So when I got the call, I knew what my position was going to be. Even though I was a lead singer in the OJs, I already knew that I would be taking Sammy's place. So I already knew that there wasn't going to be a lot of singing for me as far as doing lead vocals. I knew that I would be doing basically a lot of backgrounds, but I knew that I would have to do a lot of choreography because that's who Sammy was. Right. So I watched a lot of tapes of Sammy Strain with the OJs. Will wasn't as adamant about it. You know, he wasn't like a choreographer type guy. He was more of voice. Actually, William Powell was the lead singer of the OJs before Eddie and Walt. He was the one that was doing all the lead songs because back then, if you remember, the Temptations had Eddie Kendricks.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And so Eddie Kendricks was doing a lot of leads back then. Right. And Will was that guy for the OJs singing that pretty tenor. And Eddie and Walt, they didn't get the shot at really doing no lead vocals until maybe like Lipstick Traces. And then later on, going into the Look Over Your Shoulders and stuff like that. And then they came up with the duo when they got over to with Gambling Huff on the Backstabbers. And that's when they came up with the trade-off with Walter and Ed. So I kind of knew my position. I knew what I had to do. So when I got the call, I actually got the call on the Father and Son tour. And they had a part in the show where Gerald needed a guy to sing background, and they also needed a guy to do the third part in the OJs. So I came to a meeting one day, and they let me in this meeting, and Gerald was like, who are we going to use for the backgrounds? And actually, it was Reggie LeVert who said, what do you mean, who are you going to get to sing the guy part in the background? There was Eric sitting right there. And Gerald, and I didn't even audition. Gerald said, oh, yeah, that's right. Eric, you in. Just like that. That's exactly how it happened. I did not audition or none of that for the background part with Gerald.
Right.
So now I'm singing background with my cousin Sharina and Coco. So now
Sharina Wynn?
Yeah, Sharina Wynn. So now I'm one of the background singers. I'm still a fish out of water at this point, but still I'm cool. I'm up for the challenge. So now the OJs need a third member. So I told Gerald, I said, I can do it. And you know, they was willing to give me a shot at it, but they said, how are you going to do it? I said, I can sing all the songs in the beginning of the show. And when Gerald does I Give Anything and Everything to Fall in Love, I'll sneak off stage and I'll go and put on my OJ outfit and come out with the OJs. So every night I was doing 37 songs.
Wow.
It was a 2-hour show. So I would do the first part of the show, singing background. I would wear a cap and some glasses. And I would sing in the background. Well, then I would sneak off when Gerald, because the first part of the show, if you ever go and look at the Father and Son tour, mm-hmm. it's on CD. You'll see the first part of the show is Eddie and Gerald comes out. Then Eddie leads off and then Gerald does a segment by himself. And his very last song is I Give Everything and Everything Fall in Love. And then Gerald would sneak off, and then the OJs would come out. And then when the OJs go off, then LeVert would come out. And then the OJs would come back out with LeVert, and we would do, OJs would do LeVert's song, LeVert would do OJ's songs. And we would do it all together. But I had to stay there for the entire time, so I had to sneak off, get dressed, and come out with the OJs. Now, we were only doing, OJs were only doing 15 minutes. So I had to learn 15 minutes of choreography and singing, and then all the other stuff we basically did on stools. Cool. But the true test came in when I had to work with Charlie Atkins. Now, Charlie Atkins was the choreographer for all of the great Motown acts. Temptations, Supremes, Smokey Robinson, The Miracles, all of those cats. That was OJ's choreographer. That's where the true test came in. Can I retain the choreography for an hour and a half show, for a 90-minute show? Right. And that's why the OJs had never said that I was in the, they never said that I was in the group for 2 years. For 2 years, they never said I was the newest member, because it was another test that I had to go through. And so, what they didn't know was that I was an avid OJs fan. So I kind of like knew what my position was going to be. So, go ahead.
You knew the choreography and everything ahead of time.
I knew what they were going to do. It's just a matter of knowing how to get to it and how to chromatically do it. Because Charlie Atkins is a tap dancer. So there's a correct way to do it. The way I see it is not the correct way, but I'm familiar with what I'm supposed to do. So I asked Charlie Atkins for a bunch of tapes. So I would rehearse 6 to 8 hours with the OJs during the day. Then I would rehearse another 2 hours by myself. And I would take the TV and I would turn it cat corners towards me, where I could see Sammy and emulate what Sammy was doing. So that when I go to rehearsal the next day, then I'm kind of up on what I'm supposed to learn. Now I just need the correct way to how to do it. And then Charlie Atkins. So we had a 3-month rehearsal cut down to 2 months, because that's how bad I wanted it and how on top of my game I was. So that's basically how I got in. And then a couple years later, that's when they finally told me I had the job. And that was in 90. They told me I had the job in 98, going into 99. But I started rehearsing with them in 95. And then we went out the end of 96 into 97 on the Father and Son tour.
Well, did I answer your question?
Yeah, you did. That's quite a history right there, I'll tell you. It's quite a history. So then at what point did you decide you wanted to strike out on the solo career as well?
You know, as of today, I've been with the OJs 21 years. Next year will be 22 years for me.
Congratulations.
Thanks. I think that being realistic about this business, that Eddie and Walt's not going to be able to do it forever. And by them not being able to do it forever, I didn't want to taint the brand. First of all, let me say this. Eddie LeVert and Walter Williams are irreplaceable. There's no one that can do what they do. There's no one who has what they have when it comes to not only the business, the show business, the vocal ability, and the showmanship on stage. So I don't think I could ever replace them. And so I don't want a sound of the OJs, OJs experience, OJ review. I just rather let that go off into the sunset. So in order to do that, I still got to feed my family. I think two people that I think would make sense that would still keep the OJs intact, this is just my opinion, would be Casey and JoJo. I think they're the greatest 1-2 punch out there that would give me what I would need if they came into an OJ situation. Mm-hmm. And they bring name value, they bring market value, marquee value, and to hear them do some OJ stuff and me. And we do some Casey and JoJo stuff, and it's all in the realm of choreography and what we used to doing. I think that would be special.
Definitely.
If that could happen, you know what I mean?
Sure.
But other than that, I'm gonna let that ride off into the sunset. So in saying that, I still gotta feed my family. I still, you know, I still got bills to pay. So I said, well, why wait till the OJs is no more to be, that's the guy that used to sing in the OJs. I said, I think I can get more value out of it as a guy that's still in the OJs, and the OJs are still active and we're still selling out like everywhere. You know what I mean? I mean, we just came off tour with Gladys Knight. We sold out every single concert except for one. You know what I mean? And we had 3-4 for house with that one. So we still doing great business. You know what I mean? Yep. So I said, well, what better time to do it than now while we're still relevant? Because I think you know the saying. You know this. When an old school, what they call old school, when older acts come to the city, we seem to flock to that. We seem to sell that out. When Frankie Beverly Mays come, we're going to be there. If Patti LaBelle come, we're going to be there. If Roger Troutman, Zapp is going to be there, we're going to be there. I mean, whatever, because that was the real music back then, and that's what we gravitate to. Yeah, so when the Jays come, we sell out here every single, I have not done a show here in Cleveland that we have not sold out. So we're still relevant in this game. Yeah. We're just not relevant on the radio. If that makes sense, because radio is so different now. Yeah. So I said, well, why not try to do something while the group is still relevant and I can be attached to something? And hopefully by the time Eddie and Walt decide they want to hang it up, hopefully I'll be into my 4th, 5th CD. You know what I mean? And I've been to make a little name for myself and I can still go to work. And so that's why I decided to do it. And to add on to what your question, I didn't want to do R&B because that was our lane. That's the OJ's lane. I love contemporary jazz. Will Downing introduced me to it. That's where I got the idea from, listening to Will Downing. And so I'm like the biggest fan of Will Downing. Okay. And then I knew Kim from the flood days in Detroit when I used to live in Detroit. I lived in Detroit for 4 years. Trying to make it in the business. And so I knew Kim from working in floods. I knew him because he sounded like Alex Rowe at the time, which he still do kind of, but I knew him then. And so when Kim came out, I was like, oh, he got the style that I wanted. That's how I envisioned my style being what Kim is doing. So my partner of my label, Jay Sean Champion, I told him about it, but I said, you know what, I want to be a little bit edgier and I want to talk about it a little bit more real stuff. You know, I want to be the cool one of the contemporary jazz, you know, a little more street, you know what I mean?
So now I was reading online, I did do a little homework here, that your first CD, I believe, came out in 2012. Is that right? 2014. Okay. And the name of that CD?
Mood Swing.
Mood Swing. Excellent. And that falls in the contemporary jazz genre.
Yes, sir. Yes, okay. Sir. Deliberately, we did this, to be in that genre because I didn't want to go down the R&B street. The contemporary jazz market is ageless. It's timeless. Those songs, not only do they not die, but you don't have to be, you don't have to be tatted up. You don't have to have a six pack. You don't have to be a certain age. All you have to do is just make good music. Mm-hmm. And because we are not as mainstream, maybe, we're not as mainstream where, we put out a single and you automatically get 2 million sales, 3 million sales, and we play in big arenas. You can still survive and you can still do good business off of 100,000 sales, 75,000 sales, 150,000. If you can sell $250,000, if you can sell $250,000 units, you're pretty successful. So we're not, they don't demand as much from us. You know, companies don't demand that we sell 1 million records. You know what I'm saying? So I when I started doing Mood Swing, I had a couple of deals on the table. but they were what I call rookie deals. These rookie deals is like for people who's beginning in the business, and all these points they wanted, all these percentages they wanted. I'm like, whoa, bro, this, I really don't have to do this. You know what I'm saying? I'm kind of a vet in this game.
Right.
I'm just a newbie when it comes to doing the solo game. But when it comes to the business, I'm kind of a vet in this. You know what I mean? So I'm not gonna let you give me these contracts. So I thought about it and I said, well, what I'll do is I'll start my own label. Now that's where I'm a rookie at, because I didn't know it was going to take that much money to start it up.
Right. But and the name of your label is Boy Wonder?
Yes, sir. Boy Wonder Records. And so I got a partner that's 50% of my label. His name is Jay Sean Champion. And Jay Sean Champion is the gentleman who was responsible for the hit Same Girl by Usher and R. Kelly. And him and I became partners because I knew if I was partners with him, that I would be bringing expertise to the game of writing, producing, just the whole genius of it. Jay Sean did this entire CD.
Okay.
He did my entire CD from the beginning to the end. You know what I mean? And we came out with some really good music. So, I just think that he's a very important part of my label. So I said, I'll start a label with him. I'll do a label with him. And then we got a couple other groups. We put together a group called G-Men and Nahami and Billy Rich and Dapper. And I'm getting ready to assemble a girls group called Princess Cut.
Okay.
I'm just looking for one more female that can fit what we're trying to do. And what, you know, we want three lead singers. But we want three lead singles with their own personality and their own look, fashion look. But they all got to be fine still.
Right.
You know what I mean? And that's what I'm putting together for Princess Cut. So that's not assembled just yet. I only have two girls right now. So.
Now, are you in the studio again working on a new project for yourself on a solo side?
ASAP. We're in there right now. We're putting together an EP called OMW, On My Way. So we're putting that together as we speak. As a matter of fact, with the first single we're writing is going to be called OMW. So it don't stop. I built my own studio here. I was paying a lot of money for studio time. So what I did was, the last studio I was at, I won't tell you which one it was, but he knows. The last studio I was at, I took pictures of all his equipment and I went and bought it. And I got me a building and I got Ray Ruffin to make me build me a studio. And I put everything in that room, and me and Jay Sean, we've been down there for 5 years now.
Ray Ruffin, that's my man.
Yeah, yes, indeed. Well, so you know he's an architect.
Yes, indeed. Okay, beautiful, beautiful. Well, again, this is Jer'me Franklin here with Eric Nolan discussing his new project, his record label, Boy Wonder Records, and all of his fabulous history in the industry. I want to wish you the best of luck in everything. You're certainly welcome to come here to Valo and perform at any time. We'd love to have you here, and we definitely hope to get you here in the building to do a special show.
Well, you can ask me some more questions. You can ask me whatever you want to ask. You know that. You got it like that with me.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? I'm doing my birthday party with him next year. Yeah, I need to know. I'm July 23rd. I'm doing my birthday party with this gentleman right here.
Adult Swim 2017.
See this guy right here? I'm do that, and I might even do a song or two at his birthday, at my birthday party, at his event.
Love to have
it. Eric, when I was doing my homework, my background on you, I noticed that a lot of your background music was done by a group that performs currently right here at Valo on Thursday nights, and that's Hub's Groove. Tell me a little bit about that.
Oh man, listen. Now, let me tell you about Hub's Groove. First of all, Rodney Hubbard was one of the first guys that I started working with when I started doing, when I even thought about doing Mood Swing. Rodney used to come and work with me and in writing songs.
Okay.
Because he plays piano. Now, Robert, I got in touch with Robert to when I first started doing Moose Wings, because Robert and Rodney, they had a studio in their basement on Cedar. So I started doing it down there. I did Reminds Me. I did I Can Love You. I did When You Cry. And I did You Bring Me Joy. I did those in Robert's basement. Live music. Because Robert had a situation down there where he could do live music. So he had a whole band with Walter Barnes and his brother Rodney and Steve Fowler and all those cats. They would come down there and they would play the music. So what we would do is we would transfer the music and we would go to a bigger studio so we could put the percussions and the horns and stuff in. But we'd already laid the foundation at Robert's place. Now this is going to be good, what I'm telling you. When we got finished with this situation, of course, like I said, I got my own label. But I don't have no distribution, so I don't have nobody to kind of like pitch it to the radio stations. I was driving down the street one day and I came up with a bright idea. I said, I called Robert Hubbard, the drummer. Some people get them confused, Rodney and Robert. Yeah. I called Robert Hubbard and I said, Rob, I got an idea. And I never forget him saying, whatever you need, big bro, I'll do it. I said, okay, cool. I said, get in touch with your man, Mark Ribbons. Pitch my song to him, Reminds Me. And tell him that it's Eric Nolan featuring Hub's Groove. Because I'm just trying to get played. Right. Trying to get the record played. I don't really care whether who's on it or who's tagged on it, nothing. Because actually, Hub is playing on it. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So he's like, okay, great idea. So he got in touch with Mark Ribbons. Gave the song to Mark. Mark Ribbons fell in love with the song, added it immediately. And that's how it got on the wave. And that's why it's being played on the wave today in 2016. Mark had that song in 2014. And it was supposed to say Eric Nolan featuring Hub's Groove. But he might have said that a couple of times. And then after a while, he never said Hub's Groove no more. But still, Robert Hubbard is the reason why Reminds Me even got played in Cleveland. And I cut over half of my CD in Robert Hubbard's basement. Robert Hubbard also was the guy who put me in touch with where I could actually finish my CD at, where I wind up taking pictures of that guy's studio and getting my own studio. But Robert Hubbard, he was instrumental in all of that stuff with Eric Nolan. Very instrumental. And then Jay Sean came in, you know, put the finishing touches on it, because Jay Sean wrote all the lyrics to this stuff. Except for I Can Love You. I Can Love You, I wrote the lyrics to, which I'd done with my friend Don Williams at the time. But Robert Hubbard was so instrumental in Eric Nolan even getting to be heard in the city. So usually if Robert calls me and asks me to do something or sit in and do a song or whatever, it's a no-brainer, I do it. If Robert's down here and he asks me, come in, big brother, and do a song, I do it. It's nothing. It don't cost him a dollar.
Okay. We'll hope to have you here one of these Thursdays coming up then. Jer'me Franklin, CGTTV.
Appreciate it.